Happy birthday, Vital Pet Life! It's been a year of doing podcasts and 7 years of making sustainable products for customers of all breeds and types.
Happy 7th birthday, Vital Pet Life! I'm so excited to be part of the team, and I can't believe it's already been a year that we've been doing podcasts, Donnie.
I know, like, it's been crazy year, 1 year. But I'm excited that, you know, we were able to do like a year of podcasting, and then now we're just pretty much thinking of adding in more incredible topic that our customers will really appreciate and love. So one of this topic that we'll be doing today will be about exotic pets. Does anyone love exotic pets? Are you curious about how these pet parents take care of them? Well, indeed, it's another level of pet love, right? So we got a special guest who specializes in exotic pets.
Yes, and she is a Tucson vet with a background in avian and exotic animal medicine. She's been practicing in Tucson since 2009 and is experienced in managing various species. Hey everyone, this is Dr. Amber, your official veterinarian at Vital Pet Life.
And this is Donnie, your chief treat lady.
We're here to talk about pets, pet nutrition and wellness, anything that can help our fur children live a longer, vibrant, and happier lives.
All right.
Yeah. Welcome to Vital Pet Life Podcast.
And without further ado, let's welcome our special guest and my good friend, Dr. Julie Yeager.
Hi, Dr. Julie.
Hey guys, thanks for having me on tonight. I'm really glad to be here.
We're so glad to have you, Dr. Julie.
Yeah, we're so excited to hear about your experience and how you were able to decide to be in this side of how do you call that, like, space? Like, why exotic animals and, you know, how it all started?
Yeah, sure. So when I started vet school, I actually thought I was going to do equine or horse medicine. And then I spent a lot of time just hanging out in the zoo and exotics department. I was like, wow, these creatures are really cool. And I really liked how you have to be very creative with your medicine, because, you know, we know a lot about dog and cat and horse medicine, you know, the more common animals. But mm-hmm. when it comes to exotics, there's a lot we don't know. And so you have to think about the more common species and how medicine and their physiology applies, and then think about how the exotics are different and how that might change things. And so I really liked kind of the puzzle and the creativity of it. And so after that, I decided that I would like to learn more about it. So I spent a couple of years after vet school doing like more training, advanced training in exotic animal medicine, and then came back to Tucson at that point and started practicing as an associate for a while, and eventually opened up the clinic where I'm at now.
So that's exciting. But I'm kind of curious, like, when you mention exotic, the only thing that I can really think of is an iguana. Is that exotic? Is that considered exotic? Okay. Uh-huh. And then what about, like, maybe a snake? But is there, like, specific pet, like, that, you know, I mean, I know some people have pets as snakes and iguanas and all those stuff. But other than that, that's kind of, like, really exotic, like, too exotic that not everybody can even think that, what? People are, you know.
Yeah. So in exotics, that would pretty much include, so I see like exotic pet species, and that would be pretty much everything that's not a dog or a cat. Uh-huh. And so we'll see things like rabbits and guinea pigs and ferrets, all the way to, we see a lot of parrot species. I even had a toucan patient once. And and then reptiles, we see some pretty cool reptiles. I've seen a couple of monitor lizards, which are really, really big carnivorous lizards. And I think the coolest snake I've ever seen was a 20-foot reticulated python.
Wow.
So,
wow.
we see a very wide variety of very cool creatures.
I'm curious too, like, my gosh, like, how do you even handle This guy's like, is it the same as like how you handle like a dog or a cat when you bring them to the vet? Oh my God, it might be different.
Yeah. So yeah, it's definitely different. So the big snakes like that, usually my entire staff is involved in that appointment because she needs somebody to hold each segment of the snake.
Oh my God.
And their heads are very powerful and, you know, they have a lot of very sharp teeth. So usually one person, their job the whole time is just to restrain the head so that I don't get bit while I'm looking at the snake. Wow. So,
Oh my gosh. So, have you ever been bitten by a snake in practice?
I once got bit by a little teeny tiny baby snake because I wasn't really taking him seriously because he was so little and he bit me, but it didn't really hurt because he was so small.
Oh my God.
That's good.
Yes.
Wow. That's kind of crazy. But, another question that I'm curious about, like, what made this animals go to the vet? I mean, I know it's very specific for sure. Kind of like illnesses or like, what do they have? Is there like a certain protocol when you have like a baby snake and you wanted to have it as a pet? Is there like a certain protocol that, oh, they have to have their vaccines? Yeah, like, I mean, it's kind of dumb. It's a dumb question.
No,
but yeah.
It's not. That's a great question. So for most of our non-dog and cat species, we don't have vaccines. There's one for rabbits, but pretty much, and ferrets, I guess. But aside from that, most other animals, we don't have those preventive vaccines, but we definitely still see all of them for, we recommend at least yearly wellness exams. And like you mentioned too, when people are getting an exotic animal, we always recommend bringing them in for a new pet exam because their care is usually very specialized and very different from dogs and cats. And most of the health problems we see, I would say like 80% of them are because of husbandry related issues. So care issues or dietary issues.
Oh.
So we like to try and get them in at the beginning so we can help people feed them and care for them correctly to try and help avoid some of the health issues that we often see. So
that's great. But is this also like, because I'm sure most of these animals are purchased on a pet shop or like, it's not going to be a breeder because it's going to be weird to breed like snakes, right? Or something. But I'm just like wondering, is it really specific? Like, is this like, are the pet shop owners that are selling these exotic animals are well versed on telling the customers like, hey, you have to go and look for an exotic vet in your area before buying, right? Like, I mean,
yeah. So we see kind of a range. There are some pet stores that do a good job of educating the customers on, you know, their needs and the importance of vet care. Believe it or not, there are a ton of exotic animal breeders in the United States. And yeah, they're all kind of like special color morphs. And so they usually sell their animals over the internet and, you know, they ship them to people.
I'm just like curious. FedEx, like,
FedEx, what my question was.
Yep.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my God.
Wow. Yeah,
they come in little crates and they usually say like live animals on the side. It's crazy.
Wow.
See some breeders that are wonderful and they are true hobbyists and they really care about the animals and really help their customers set them up well. And then we see the other end of the spectrum too, where, they just got them from a breeder at the reptile show and they know zero about how to take care of them. And, you know, they didn't get any information on them. So,
oh, God.
Yeah.
Oh, no. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Like, have you thought of that, Dr. Amber, that it's a certain thing?
I mean, for sure. I think that happens in dog and cat medicine too. In dog and cat practice, like you'll get someone who lives in an apartment and they get like a healer and they wonder why the dog is chewing up everything in their house and has behavioral issues and stuff. Like they're not prepared for the temperament of the dog. So I'm sure for exotic animals, it's just magnified
for sure. Like we get a lot, like that's one of the questions that we have for Dr. Julie, you know, the temperament of this exotic animals, like how can an owner or like a human like caretaker be ready for that?
So you know, again, and because these guys are exotic animals, they're not usually domesticated the way that we think of dogs and cats and horses. You know, those animals, we've bred them for thousands and thousands of years, and they are very, very accustomed to living with people. You know, exotic animals, a lot of times they're only a few generations from the wild, or some of them are even wild caught. And so they are truly wild animals. And because of that, they are naturally afraid of humans. And so it can take a lot of work to tame them and, you know, get them to a point where they're not afraid to be handled. And then, you know, I guess along those lines too, there are some exotic species like parrots, for example, that not only are they technically wild animals, they're also extraordinarily intelligent, and they have a very strong weapon attached to their face, their beak. Their bite force is unbelievable. You know, they are able to crack open like a Brazil nut with no effort at all. So you imagine you've got this animal that's oftentimes afraid of people, or we don't communicate as well with them as we do with dogs and cats. And, you know, so they get frustrated or scared, and then they bite with that very strong beak. And so we see that kind of situation a lot with different exotics. They certainly can. I don't know if I would say they're temperamental as much as we don't understand them as well as dogs and cats. And then they have, you know, weapons such as beaks or claws or teeth. And, you know, that can end up being dangerous for people. So that's another thing too. I always encourage people, before you get an exotic species, do as much reading and research as you can ahead of time so that you can learn what their temperament is like, what their psychological requirements are even, and what kind of enrichment they need in their life. So yeah, that's we see quite a variety of creatures and temperaments for sure.
Yeah. I don't know if you guys are aware of it, that there's so many parrots or parakeets, they call it parakeets here in LA, and they have all these stories and how they get here, like in 70s, like they thought that it was released during the LA riots and all those stuff. But it's funny, I do get them hanging out in our yards.
Wow.
And they're just so loud, and
yes.
And I'm like, it's just like, and then it's funny too, because sometimes I feel like, okay, oh, it's springtime, like one of the trees that I knew doesn't have leaves, I'm like, oh, they're turning green, and then staring at it, the next thing I just saw like a bunch of, like, you know, like a school of like parrots were just flying. I'm like, oh my god, it's the crazy guys. That's why they're so loud. But yeah, you see that everywhere here in LA. Like,
wow.
They're all wild. And yeah, it's fun to read all the rumors and how they get here in LA. Because they're not,
they're not a native species.
No. Mm-hmm. And they're green. Yeah, it's really, they really have this like really nice color to the green and red.
Are they, I know down, I think more towards San Diego, there's a, we call them feral populations when they're non-native species that is living well in the wild. So there's a feral population of Amazon parrot.
So it's the green one with a red by the, like, the chin.
Yep.
So that's the one?
That's
okay.
What it
yeah.
is.
Okay. Yeah. They're everywhere, and they're just too loud. And then I'm like, what is that stuff happening outside, Kyle? And Kyle were like, oh my God, they're on our wire. Like 7 or 8 of them. And the wire like, ah. I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah.
Wow, they're, I had no idea.
Loud and smart and destructive.
Oh, okay. Well, I haven't seen the destruction yet.
But that's good. I'm glad they're not like chewing through the wires or anything.
No, they're just really loud. And sometimes they hang on trees, and you're in a coffee shop here in LA, like you'll be like, what's happening here? And then you look, they're just hanging.
Yep.
Wow.
Oh my gosh. But yeah, that's really interesting. But here's another question that I'm curious. What's the most friendly exotic pet that you have like taken care of or like handled?
So that's an excellent question. So I would probably say guinea pigs are probably the friendliest exotic pet. Are little small mammals like that that are herbivores. They tend to be a lot more docile, and they do seem to enjoy human interaction a lot. So, and sometimes I have definitely met some parrots that are extremely friendly and love most people, but as a whole, I would say, some of our small mammals are probably the friendliest. Ferrets are pretty friendly too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's funny too. Like, we do get a lot of ferrets, like people using our product through their ferrets. So is there anything that you could like give light to that? Like, I know ferrets is also considered an exotic animal. Like,
Yeah.
yeah.
So I imagine a lot of people are probably using the salmon oil, especially. So ferrets, they love salmon oil. And so a lot of times we'll use it as either a treat or a distraction, even in the clinic. Like if we have to trim their nails, that's a great way for positive reinforcement, to so that we don't have to stress them out while they're getting their nail trimmed. We just put a little salmon oil on a tongue depressor and they just lick that away while they're getting their nail trimmed.
Oh
So
my God, that's
I
awesome.
think, yeah, a lot of people use that, and it's a great alternative to another product that it's kind of like a molasses-based sugary syrup that it's called ferritone that people use for ferrets a lot. But ferrets get this health problem with their pancreas where they make too much insulin. And if they eat sugar, it makes it much, much worse. And so, if salmon oil is a great alternative to that because there's zero sugar in that. So, we
Wow,
try
like
to
I mean
encourage people to do salmon
I
oil
heard
instead of.
just
So.
the sugary one. I heard that they're pretty smart too. Like when I look at them, I kinda it are they in the squirrel family? Like they kinda look like squirrels to me when I look at them. Like I'm like they have the body and
Yeah,
the
they do kind of. They're in the weasel family.
Oh,
So,
weasel.
what else is in there? Badgers, the black-footed ferrets, stoats, little weaselly creatures like that.
Like ermines.
Yes. And they're also carnivorous, which also makes salmon oil. That's another reason that they like it. And I do use it for ferrets that have dermatitis or skin issues too,
Oh,
just
it's
like we do
exactly the
for dogs and cats.
same.
Yeah.
Wow,
So,
that's so interesting.
yeah.
Wow, how long do these pets or exotic pets live? Like, I bet longer. Like, I mean, the tortoise, is that an exotic pet? Okay, yeah, I feel like they live long, long time. Like,
Yeah, that is very true. Most tortoises, their average lifespan is usually between 60 and 100 plus years of age. So yeah,
oh
tortoises are
my
they're
God, they're gonna
Oh
outlive
yeah. Yes, most people have to have their tortoises in their will so that they know what to do with them when they die. And then,
Oh.
there's definitely a range. There are some other species that have a very short lifespan, like rats, for example. They live
What?
On average about 2 years. There's some little chameleons that only live like 1 or 2 years. And then there's parrots too, that their average lifespan is 60 to 80 years. So again, that's a lifetime commitment when you get one of
60
those
to 80
birds.
years? Oh my God. Oh, I don't know, like if like I've seen this like lady that does like animal communication and she's from Africa, and there was a story about this I forgot it, but it was a parrot, but I think the family left her behind, something like that. And the whole time, like she was just in the cage, like it was a sanctuary we're in for rescued parrots, and she could never be on the wild because she would prefer to be in the cage and will just start like yelling. And then so they asked her to visit and see what's really happening. And when she really saw and talked to the parrot and the family that took care of her and raised her left, the parrot was just saying that she was really brokenhearted.
Yeah, that's definitely, again, they're such intelligent species. It's very common for them to mourn the loss of other family members, you know, other animals or humans in the household. And, you know, that's something that happens because these are very long-lived birds. I actually work with a bird sanctuary, the Oasis Sanctuary, and they truly are a sanctuary. So a lot of their residents have come there because their owners have passed away, and you know they've willed them to the sanctuary. And so we see that in some of these birds, you know, they definitely go through a mourning time, you know, when their humans pass away. But and so that's what, you know, at this sanctuary, there's about 800 plus birds there. A lot of them come from situations where they outlive their owners. So that's definitely something that, you know, again, when you're getting a potentially long-lived exotic species, it's something that you have to think about. You're planning for them beyond your own lifespan.
Oh, wow. So. I know. It's so sad. Like, at first I was like, yeah, right. Like, then, you know, the whole story was like, you know, after she explained that they left her behind, she died of a heartache the next day. And I'm like, what? That's so sad. But apparently she was really grieving that, you know, she was left behind.
Yeah. And, you know, from like the science side of that too. So also kind of, well, maybe it's not cool for the birds, but interesting that they get the same kind of heart disease that we do. So they get plaque buildup in their arteries, and then they can have stroke and heart attack. And a lot of times after a stressful event like that, they can have a fatal stroke.
Poor guy.
So I wonder, maybe something like that happened. She scientifically kind of died of a broken heart too.
Yeah, for sure. Because like that was a really, I think, I will send you the video, Dr. Amber. Like, it was really interesting, and it really made me sad. And I'm like, wow, like, these animals, like, they really get attached to us, you know?
Yeah, they do.
Yeah. Yeah. So sad. Yeah.
Yeah. So one thing that has been on my mind is salmon. I mean, we love salmon oil, of course, for dogs and cats, for sure. But what about the small furry herbivores like rabbits and guinea pigs? What do you think?
Yeah, sure. So there's kind of like, I guess the short answer is we don't know for sure how good fish oil specifically is for small herbivores, because, you know, it's not a natural part of their diet. Of course, they only eat plant material, but we do know that just like with other species, they probably benefit from omega-3 fatty acids. And it's really challenging to get that right balance between 3 and 6 fatty acids for the anti-inflammatory effects from other non-fish sources. Mm-hmm. So because of that, a lot of people just go ahead and use the salmon oil in small mammals, you know, when they need to. And I certainly have not seen any negative effects of that. And I have not heard any colleagues saying so. But, you know, again, this definitely falls in one of those areas like we see a lot with exotic animal medicine where we don't have the research. No one's done it. So we don't know for sure. So,
yeah,
we're kind of extrapolating from what we know with dogs and cats.
For sure. Like, there's a lot of stuff that we don't know. Like, just being in this business opened my mind to a lot of things. I'm not sure if I mentioned this to Dr. Amber, like a few years, like we were getting like an email from a dolphin sanctuary somewhere in British Island somewhere. And they were buying our fish oil because one of the dolphins that they were taken care of was pretty much like born out of captivity. And it was like a sanctuary. He was placed back to the, you know, the group was able to take him back and take care of it. And very picky. And he needs omega-3s. And I'm like, what? Why would an dolphin need
some? Interesting. Yeah.
And I'm like, what? It's really something. Like, there's a lot of stuff that you uncover when it comes to animal health.
Yeah.
Really excited, though, that Dr. Julie is here. Is there, like, anything that you think supplementation other than the almond oil that you usually give to these exotics? Or is there, like, specific vitamins that is already out in the market that you can just say, oh, you can use this for the animals? Or
yeah, so, you know, depending on the exotics, the small mammals, a lot of times we'll have them on, so we do use glucosamine chondroitin when they get older and get our arthritic. There's a couple of companies that are specialized in like supplements and foods for small exotic mammals, but you don't have to use that. You know, you can use any glucosamine chondroitin. Yeah. For reptiles, we actually have to do calcium and D3 supplementation for a lot of them because the way that their calcium metabolism works, they get their calcium from UV light. Mm. And they need a lot of vitamin D3 in their diet to be able to, well, the UV light helps to convert it to the active form, but that's how they absorb their calcium. And so those guys, they're getting calcium D3 regularly. And then a lot of them need like multivitamin supplements too. Frogs oftentimes need a lot of vitamin A.
So what do you give? Do you supplement with vitamin A or do they get it in their diet?
For the frogs, you do have to supplement. So most frogs are eating little insects. I've got a dart frog, for example, and he eats little fruit flies. And so a couple times a week, I use like a multivitamin powder and I'll dust the fruit flies with the multivitamin before I feed it to him. Wow. And then he'll get like a calcium supplement once a week. And again, you dust the fruit flies. So they're all covered in calcium before he eats them.
Are those the fruit flies without wings so that they don't like get loose in your place?
Yeah, they are flightless fruit flies. They still have wings. They're just not very functional wings. But when you get a fruit fly culture, so the fruit fly culture, it has a bunch of fruit flies in there and then it's got nutrients for them to eat. And they'll go through several generations in that culture. And so, you know, they lay eggs, the maggots grow and then pupate and turn into more fruit flies. I know it's disgusting, but so a lot of times with each subsequent generation, they lose a little bit of their flightlessness. And so sometimes they revert back to flying fruit flies, and then it's a pain because then you've got fruit flies flying everywhere.
I know that's like my pet peeve. Like, you know, when we open, like, I'm like, no, take it out. Like, especially when you have like bananas out for a long time. My gosh. I have another question for that. Like, where do they live? Like, are you putting them inside the house or outside the house or in the garage?
So the like the frogs, for example, usually they're kept in terrariums, which is kind of like an aquarium. Without the water. Yeah. And a lot of people do what's called a bioactive terrarium, where you have beneficial insects and bacteria and molds. And then you have like live plants in there. And so there's like this whole ecosystem that, you know, the critters and the molds take care of the dead organic matter, you know, like the dead plant matter and stuff. And so that's how most people keep them. And then you have special lighting, and some of these guys need like either heating or cooling as well. And so most people have thermostats, so you can tell, you know, where your temperatures and humidities are and adjust as needed. So it's pretty complex.
How long does it take? Like, if you get a new frog and you set up a terrarium like that, how long does it take for the environment to get established before you can put that frog in? Or do you put them in at the beginning and they all kind of work together to establish it?
Yeah, that's actually a great question. You leave it to kind of acclimate for about 6 to 8 weeks before putting the frog in.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
So would you set it up before you get your frog then?
Yes, that would be the ideal situation. Okay. So when I did it, I got my frog when he was a tadpole.
So did you really see him transform or is it
I did. Yeah, and I took like pictures along the way. So, but when they're a tadpole, you keep them in water, obviously. So while he was still metamorphosizing, I set up his terrarium and, you know, gave it its, you know, 8 weeks to balance out. And then by that time he was turned into a frog and ready to go in his new home.
Wow, that's so cool.
That's interesting. Yeah. Well, thinking about like, I just, you know, something just basically reminded me, like I've seen a post in Instagram, like I follow a lot of like rescues here in LA and they posted something about you're looking for a foster for otters.
Oh, goodness.
I'm like, what is it? They're like, oh, it's otter season, or they need homes, like specifically like for people that are willing to foster, but we want it with pools that are saltwater infused or something like that. And I'm like, what's happening here? Like otters? Yeah. So have you guys like heard about that, or is just like an LA thing?
I think that probably must be an LA thing. So, you know, in Arizona, we don't really have very many otters because it's pretty dry. But
yeah.
So that type of animal in most places that would fall into the category of illegal pet. So my guess is that these groups, perhaps they're rescues or, you know, like wildlife rescue, and maybe they have special permits. No. Oh, goodness. No.
Yeah, they're like dog rescues. I've seen it on Instagram. That's why I was kind of surprised. Goodness. And I just Googled because I really want to see before I even like want to put it out here. But yeah, there is. I need to, you know, dig in more, and probably I will ask questions. Like, I want to see why they're doing that.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Yeah, most species, if they're like native to the area, that they're almost always illegal to keep as pets.
Yeah.
And then other pets or animals that if they were to escape would be invasive, those are also usually going to be considered illegal. Mm. So, and it varies state to state, but no. I'm fairly certain otters are probably illegal in most states.
For sure. Like, that's why it shocked me. I'm like, that's strange.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I will dig in. I'll educate myself, and I want to see what's happening. You know, maybe there's a reason for it that fosters or the rescues are going in and really help. So maybe there's really like a need. I don't know.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Recently, just in the last couple of months, there was rescue group, wildlife rescue in northern Utah that was shut down. Not shut down, but the owner of the building didn't renew their lease, and they were tearing it down to build something new. And so they had to get, like, they had to find a new facility and get all of their animals out. And so they were reaching out, and it just reminded me because one of them was an otter. And in their old facility, they had a large pool area where they could keep some of those species that are, you know, water primarily. But they didn't have that kind of facility in the new building that they were able to lease. And so they were trying to find a rescue group to take on this otter. But I'm pretty sure it was like a specific, you know, wildlife rescue. And they were reaching out to some of the neighboring states to see if they could find a home for this otter.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah. It's a dog rescue that I've seen that I follow in Instagram, but we'll see. I'm going to read more of the posts. Like, so it was just, at first it was, is this a joke? Like April Fool's?
Right? Yeah.
But yeah. I'm like, I just Google. I'm like, oh yeah, they really posted it on Instagram. But yeah, I'll look it up.
Have you ever worked on an otter?
No, actually I've not worked on an otter before. I've seen some, you know, more like zoo animals as opposed to exotic pets, but not an otter.
They're so cute though. Like
they're really cute.
They're like dogs of the seas.
Yeah.
Oh gosh. Is there anything else, Dr. Amber, that you can, add in, like now that we have Dr. Julie?
Yeah. So we have a couple of questions about hedgehogs. So we're wondering about the living conditions of hedgehogs, if they can stay in colder rooms, like rooms with AC, or what kind of temperatures they need.
Yeah. So most hedgehogs do well in just normal, like what's comfortable for us is usually fine for them too. If you keep your AC in the 50s, that might be a little bit much for them. Or if you're one of those people that's super cold all the time and leave your AC at like the high 80s, that might be pushing it a little. But generally room temperature, they do pretty well with.
Okay. And should they get baths? And if so, how often?
So you can bathe hedgehogs. It's not a requirement so long as their skin and quills are healthy, but some people like to do it. And I probably, just like with, same as with dogs and cats, we probably wouldn't recommend doing it more than like once a week to every other week, just because, you know, bathing does tend to dry their skin out a little bit. But yeah, they do like water. If you, you know, whenever you pick a hedgehog up, they ball up into their little spiky ball. And a lot of times if you set them in the water, so they're generally rather fat creatures, and so they have a high fat volume. So that kind of makes them float. And so you stick them in the water, and they're kind of sitting there floating ball. And usually that'll make them want to open up their legs and come out of their ball. We actually use that as a trick if we're trying to do an exam on a hedgehog and we can't get it to open up. We'll just float it in the water for a minute, and usually it'll come out of its little ball.
That is so cool.
I think that's one of the fun facts. Yeah. Oh my goodness. Is there any more fun fact that you can share, Dr. Julie?
Sure. Yeah. So, you know, we were talking about earlier how parrots are very intelligent. And there are a couple of species that really do seem to be able to assign meaning to words. So African greys, for example, are notorious for that. And you can almost have a real conversation with an African grey. They usually, they can identify people by name. If they want food or water, a lot of times they will specifically ask for it. Or, you know, if there's a toy that they like, they might ask for their toy. So, it's very interesting. It's actually a pet that you can have a conversation with.
That is very cool. And how long do they typically live?
African greys, their natural lifespan is about 60 years.
Okay.
To be honest, though, in captivity, we don't often see them living that long because they are very, very prone to that heart disease that we were talking about.
And, okay.
We lose a lot of them to stroke and heart attack by the time they're in their 30s.
Think it's our nature too, like being the caretakers. Like if they're in nature, like they can figure out like when to eat, but just living with us, like probably.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah. Our environment and captivity and diet is not at all close to what they're eating and doing in the wild. You know, they're spending all day flying around, and the food that they have access to, it's, you know, whatever forage is in season at that time of year. And so, when we have them in captivity, we usually make them perch potatoes. You know, they're hanging out on the perch all day doing a whole lot of nothing. Yeah. And then we put this giant bowl of high fat, high sugar food right in front of them, and they just eat to their heart's content. And so, you know, it's kind of like the same kind of sedentary lifestyle that we battle ourselves.
So, but that's so sad, though, because we're cutting their lifespan into half. Like, it's so crazy.
Yeah. And I do think that, you know, probably over the past 10 years or so, we've started to recognize this because a lot of parrots are kind of new into the pet trade, as in, you know, maybe the last 40 to 50 years. So we're seeing these birds aging now and developing these problems and starting to recognize that we need to kind of change how we're keeping them and treating them to try and help prevent that. So
it's crazy.
Yeah.
Talk about the ferrets. We talk about the parrots. We talk about the frog. We talk about a little bit of snakes. We talk about the otter. What else? There was another hedgehog. What else do you think that we haven't really covered that you see that is purely common in a lot of, you know, patients, but we haven't discussed or covered in this? Like, we haven't discussed anything about them yet. Yeah. Any animal.
Like, are you talking about like what other
exotic pet, that you've seen that in your office that is not, that we haven't discussed? Animals, yeah.
Okay. So, I guess they're not super common, but I guess one of the coolest ones that we see is, it's kind of like a salamander. It's called an axolotl.
Oh,
have you guys seen those before? They're very cool. They look like a salamander, but they've got gills too. So they've got gills that kind of come off the side of their head. So they have lungs and gills.
Is this the pink one?
Yeah.
And they always look like they're smiling.
Yeah. Oh my God. Is this like, oh my goodness. Like, it looks like a meme or something.
It totally does. Yeah. They're becoming a lot more common in the pet trade. And, you know, they have very specialized needs. But something that's super cool about them, they have the ability to regenerate their limbs. So if they lost a leg, they just grow back. So
And you see that you get to see that. Uh-huh. Oh my goodness!
How long does it take?
Yeah,
it takes probably like weeks to months.
Okay, yeah. Interesting.
It's not quick, but yeah.
So when they cut it off, like of course there'll be blood, right? And then it just dries out, and then slowly, like it just comes in.
Yeah, like a little stump forms, and then it gets longer and longer.
Oh my
and then
God.
Little toes grow. Uh-huh.
Wow, oh that's crazy.
I don't know if I want to keep that in the house.
So actually, Julie, I remember having a conversation with you about an axolotl patient with the water temperature, and then it got a really bad skin infection.
Yes. Yeah, so that's probably one of the most common things that we see with them. So, you know, most animals, we think that about having to keep them warm, they need cold water. And room temperature is too hot. So you have to have water coolers. And when the water's too warm, it suppresses their immune system. And their skin is very absorbent. And, you know, they actually do some oxygen exchange and some nutrient exchange through their skin. So it also makes it very prone to bacterial infection. So if the water's too hot, and they get kind of like a disruption of that normal mucus layer on their skin, and it lets bacteria and fungus in, and then they can get really severe infections from that.
So how do you treat that? Do you just put medication into the water?
So that's one way. We can do medicated baths. Okay. And so you wouldn't put it in like their home aquarium. You'd use like a smaller enclosure and put the medication in and let them sit in it for a while. You can do oral medications for them too. Sometimes we'll take like injectable medications and just drip it on their skin. So there's lots of different ways that you can medicate them. Yeah.
It's my mind is like, Yeah, Dr. Amber, so do you have anything else? I don't have any other questions, but I'm just like in awe, like, wow. Yeah. There's just so much stuff that we don't really know.
Yeah. So
sure.
Thinking back on your career and all the exotic pets you've seen, what do you think is the most challenging type of animal or even a specific case that you can think of that you've seen?
So, you know, probably the most challenging animals are, well, probably some of the reptiles, some of the lizards in particular, because again, their needs are so very specialized. You have to have special lighting, special heating. You have to have very specific humidity. Their diets are often very specialized. And we don't know the exact details of every species needs too. So we're kind of battling that as well. And so because of that, it makes it more challenging, one, to keep them, and two, when they come in with problems, can be a little bit more difficult to diagnose. Some of those guys too, they're teeny, teeny, tiny. And so
I'm just like, how can you like dissect everything?
Yeah. So we can be very limited in what kind of diagnostics we can do. For example, there's a chameleon species, they're pygmy chameleons that they weigh probably about 500 milligrams. So, you know, that's like, if you think about it, 500 milligrams, that's like two ibuprofen tablets. They're tiny. So, you know, and you have a sick animal that comes in like that, and it's like, well, gosh, we're not going to be able to take a blood sample because our sample would be their entire blood volume.
Exactly. And,
you know, taking x-rays can even be difficult because the machine is too big and it just burns right through them. So you don't see much. So that makes it very challenging. You know, if we're definitely limited in what we know about them and what we can do with them. So again, that's where a lot of creativity comes in.
Wow.
Luckily, you guys are very well versed in it, then you know you have experience to help these guys.
Yeah, and again, we're always learning. And I think Dr. Amber would probably say that too. You know, it probably doesn't matter what species you're seeing, but we are always learning more through our entire career.
Yeah,
for sure, yeah, for sure. Absolutely. And technology too. I mean, there's a lot of new stuff that are, like, I'm pretty excited about, like, the new innovation in dog lifespan research, like a lot of stuff.
The canine aging project.
I'm excited for that. Like Tuxedo now is currently taking another supplement that can help, like, you know, help them with inflammation, like, other than my current supplement. So I'm testing a lot of stuff, and I can really see the change. Like, he's more spikier. Like, you've heard him today. Like, he's the one that really, like, yells a lot. But yeah, there's a lot of new stuff that are coming out. So it's exciting.
Yeah, exciting times for sure.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Amber, do you want to chime in? Anything else?
I guess, just some takeaways. What would you recommend for someone who wants to get an exotic pet?
Yeah. So, first step, before you go and make that purchase, do a lot of reading.
Research.
Yes. A lot of research. Make sure you know how you need to house them, what their food requirements are, what their lifespan is. To make sure that that's going to be a good fit for you. And then the second thing, you want to bring them in for a vet exam within the first couple weeks of getting them to make sure that there's no health issues. And again, just to help make sure you're on the right track with their care and diet and all of that too.
Yeah, you can definitely prevent, like, treat early if you find something, and prevent a lot of husbandry related issues if you know what you're doing before they get sick.
Exactly.
You know how to take good care of them.
Yeah, exactly. That's true.
Well, thank you, Dr. Julie, so much for joining us today. You just amaze me, all of your knowledge and all of your experience. I always found it hard enough to just, you know, work on dogs and cats and try to remember everything I needed to. And so just your knowledge is amazing.
I know.
Thank you for what you do for all of our exotic pets.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Julie.
Yeah. Thank you, Donnie and Dr. Amber. It was really fun getting to chat with you guys tonight.
Knowledge is key. And I hope for those of you who want to adopt exotic animals that you make sure to remember some of the things that we've discussed tonight with Dr. Julie.
Yeah, with all the facts, it's great to learn more and gain knowledge about exotic pets.
Thank you once again, Dr. Julie, for joining us and being our special guest tonight.
Yeah, thanks again for having me, guys.
That's it for today's exotic and special episode. Don't forget to follow our channel and more talks about pets, tips, advice, and fun stuff.
Happiness, vibrance, and longevity for our fur babies and our planet.
Once again, thank you for tuning in, our dear listeners. This is Donnie, your chief treat lady at Vital Pet Life.
And this is Dr. Amber, your official veterinarian at Vital Pet Life. Have a possum day.